Shana Tova, everyone. We begin the words of Ya'ale Koleinu. We ask God to lift up our voices.
Chatima Tova, everyone. Welcome. Great opening song, Koleinu, which is the name of this service, really means our voice. And so tonight, and if you join us again tomorrow, it's of course the beautiful voices of the musicians and the singers and the cantor, but also your voices. So I want to just introduce our team. I'm Rabbi Joel Nickerson.
I'm Cantor Lisa Peicott.
We also have Rabbi Joel Simons and Rabbi Bo Shapiro, who are going to be with us tonight, and Rabbi Shapiro will be giving the sermon later this evening. But before we really dive into the service, we're very lucky to have the president of our board of trustees, Scott Edelman, here. And he's going to share some words and do the state of the presidential address for all of you tonight so that you can get a little bit of an update and understand what has been going on for the last year or so. And it's really thanks to Scott's leadership that our institution has been able to really weather the storm of COVID and all the challenges that we have been facing in Los Angeles and throughout the world. So I want to have Scott please come up here and share some words with us. Thank you for being here.
Good evening. Dear members, clergy, staff, faculty, and trustees, it is my honor and privilege as the 27th president of Wilshire Boulevard Temple to address you in this magnificent setting. How good it is to be together. Teshuvah is our tradition during these high holy days to return and reflect. Before we enter the solemn and exquisite moments of Kol Nidrei, I'll take just a few moments to reflect on the temple and our future. This past year has been both tumultuous and exhilarating. There have been, for sure, many challenges. Abraham Joshua Heschel observed that we have no answers to the ultimate problems. We really don't know. But he said, in this not knowing lies the key to opening the wells of creativity. As they have throughout the pandemic, clergy and temple leadership have had to make difficult and consequential decisions, opening, as Heschel says, the wells of creativity to navigate the tempest of our times. And they have done an outstanding job. Imagining a vibrant center for Jewish life in Los Angeles enabled the merger of Wilshire Boulevard Temple and University Synagogue, bringing us together as one congregation with the best of all that has distinguished University Synagogue and Wilshire Boulevard Temple for generations. And this summer, thanks to the cornerstone gift by Linda and Stuart Resnick, for whom the Campus and Early Childhood Center are now named, and lead gifts by Goldsmith Family Foundation for the Elaine and Bram Goldsmith Religious School, and Bruce and Martha Karsh for Karsh West, extensive renovation of the facilities at Wilshire Boulevard Temple's Resnick campus are now underway and will be completed in 2023. When it reopens, the campus will have its magnificent sanctuary and soaring stained glass windows, inviting social halls for events and activities, beautiful modern classrooms for early childhood and religious school, a convenient location for adult daytime programming, and space for more hearts and souls to engage in the vital Tikkun Olam efforts of the Karsh Center. I want to extend a special welcome tonight to everyone from the university community who are with us. While we still have to raise an additional $20 million, that's all, to complete that renovation, we know with everyone's help, we will get there. The beautiful Audrey Irmas Pavilion, now fully operational with events booked every week, is exhilarating. The stunning landmark, which further expresses our role as a steadfast institution of learning, gathering, and giving, has earned numerous awards for its design and architecture. One need only look around to understand why. It is also home to the Wallace Annenberg Foundation's Gen Space, welcoming senior Angelinos to a wide array of programs and services. Last week on Rosh Hashanah, the very first of our services to fill to capacity was the one for families with children in nursery school through first grade. The afternoon family service for families with children in second grade and above attracted almost 1,000 people, not to mention the Koleinu service that filled the Audrey Irmas Pavilion then and now. I see this and I think of L'Dor V'Dor as we pass our heritage and traditions from generation to generation, with each generation honoring the past and embracing the future in its own way. What will be our legacy? Will we do as well as prior generations at passing along our traditions, our values, and our identity to our children and our grandchildren? In the spirit of passing the Torah from generation to generation, we must be meaningful and relevant to rising generations. The size and the intellectual diversity of our congregation creates opportunities for everyone at every stage of life, young and old, to participate and find meaning and substance. But we all know that Torah is about more than beautiful buildings. It is incumbent on us to convey the values and the spirituality of our faith to our children and to involve ourselves in the life and fabric of our temple and our broader community. We now run 8 extraordinary schools, 3 religious schools, 3 early childhood centers, and 2 elementary schools. In order to elevate our schools to the next level, we have brought on board Naomi Ra'em as Executive Director of Education. Naomi has assembled a team of educators, lay leaders, and staff to chart the path for the future of our elementary schools and early childhood centers. Excellence begets excellence. The Karsh Family Social Service Center remained open throughout the pandemic, expanding its outreach, providing vital food and other services to thousands. To the Karsh Center staff and volunteers, thank you for extending the helping hand of Wilshire Boulevard Temple and the Jewish people to our neighbors in need. The work you do makes an important difference in people's lives, and we all are so proud of your incredible achievements. While our camps suffered a terrible loss in the Woolsey Fire in 2018, plans to rebuild are progressing. We especially thank the Jewish Caucus, the Los Angeles Jewish Federation, and our own Mark Weinstein's leadership for their efforts in securing $23.5 million of state funding to help that rebuilding effort. We still have a way to go, and much more is needed, but we will get it done because we know Jewish camping shapes the hearts of the next generation of Jewish leaders. As I look back on my first year as Temple President, I am deeply proud of what Wilshire Boulevard Temple offers to each of us and to the community. We have been bringing people together to learn, to grow, to share joy, and find comfort in sorrow, to give back and help others since our founding 160 years ago. We have a great past on which our history rests and a great future ahead of us. Shana Tova.
starting about the second week of August, Julia, my wife, turns to me and she says, I guess I'll see you at Thanksgiving. Because, as you can imagine, this fall season is very busy for us clergy and those who work in the Jewish world. So I'm very lucky that tonight my family is here, and I want to invite them up to light candles, my wife Julia, and my daughters Ella, Kayla, and Rebecca. I'm not always home on Friday nights to light candles with them, and so it's very special that tonight we get to stand together as a family and light these Yom Tov candles. If you want to follow along, it's on page 9.
Continue with the words of the Shehecheyanu, which you can also find at the bottom of page 9.
Baruch Ata Adonai,
Holy One,
Eloheinu Melech Haolam,
Your presence fills creation.
You
was a traveler who came across three stone cutters, and this traveler wanted to know what they were doing. So he walked up to the first stone cutter and said, well, what are you doing? And the first stone cutter said, I'm cutting a stone. Not really clear on what they were doing, the traveler went to the second one and asked, what are you doing? And the second one said, well, I am making sure that this stone is perfectly square. Travelers, that was a little bit more specific, but not enough. Finally, went to the third stone cutter and said, what are you doing? And the stone cutter said, I'm building a palace. Three stone cutters doing the same thing, but three very different answers. And that's why we are here tonight, because there are three ways I think that you can engage in the next 24 hours. One is to just take this as it's your job and obligation to come to Yom Kippur services. The second is to believe that you are coming here because, like the second stone cutter, there's something you're supposed to do. You are part of something. And the third is to really recognize that this is your opportunity to build a palace, that you have 24 hours to not just go through the motions, to not just listen to what we're talking about and to listen to the music, but to do the work of building your own palace. So that when we finish Yom Kippur tomorrow afternoon, you can walk into this next year feeling like you have already started to do the work. So that's what we're going to try and do together. Yes, we're each individually going to be going on our own journey and building our own palace, but What we are going to be trying to do with you for the next 24 hours, both tonight and if you come back and be with us tomorrow at 11:30, we're trying to create a space where you can find your own vulnerability, your own way into the service, so that you can do that work and come out at the end of Yom Kippur feeling like you didn't just go through the motions, but that you did the work. And I'm telling you, I mean, even on Rosh Hashanah as the service leader, I was able to pray. And that doesn't always happen when you're leading services. But I know that in this community and with this group, we can do the work. And so I hope you'll come on the journey with us so that we can all build a palace together. In a moment, we are going to be bringing in the Torahs. The Ark will be opened, and you'll notice that it's empty. And the whole idea of bringing these Torahs in, we're very lucky that we have Deborah Dragon, who's a member of our Board of Trustees, and Donna Nadel, who is our Executive Director of this synagogue. They are the two that are going to be carrying in those Torahs. And the whole idea is that if we look into that empty Ark, we're supposed to imagine that it is like a casket, it is like a coffin, and how are we going to fill it? And so that is what we are going to keep in mind as we then listen to Kol Nidrei this evening. So in a moment, the cantor will start, and then when I do open the Ark, and when those Torahs do come in, I will ask that you rise at that time.
B'shiva shel mala, u'b'shiva shel mata, al dat ha-makom, ve'al dat ha-kahal, anu matirin lehipalel, im havarianim, b'shiva shel mala, ובשיבה של מטה על דת המקום ועל דת הקהל אנו מתירים להתפלל עם הווריאנים בשיבה של מעלה ובשיבה של מטה על דת המקום ועל דת הקהל אנו מתירים להתפלל Im havarianim.
Page 19, 18. all vows, resolves and commitments, vows of abstinence and terms of obligation, sworn promises and oaths of dedication that we promise and swear to God and take upon ourselves from this day of atonement until the next day of atonement. May it find us well. We regret them, and for all of them we repent. Let all of them be discarded and forgiven, abolished and undone. They are not valid and they are not binding. Our vows shall not be vows, our resolves shall not be resolves, and our oaths, they shall not be oaths.
Oh.
remain standing for our call to our Kol Nidrei prayers, the Baruch Hu on page 22.
God loves you. You know, it's not something we say in Judaism too much. We've kind of allowed the Christians to take that phrase. But the truth is, we invented it. It started with us. This whole idea of God loves you comes from our tradition, and it comes from this next prayer. But what's interesting and what differentiates the Jewish way in which God loves us as opposed to other traditions is that God doesn't love us by allowing us to just swipe away our sins, or that God is going to do that for us, because that would be counter to the concept of free will, which we in Judaism hold up very dearly in our tradition. So how is it that God shows God's love to us? According to this prayer and throughout our tradition, God shows God's love through Torah and basically through teaching. It's through teaching that we express love. And it's not just teachers, though there are some in the room, and thank you to those of you who are teachers. The truth is, every single one of us is a teacher in one way or another. I mean, we know that from those of us who have children, that it's not just when we literally teach them. They are watching everything that Julia and I do, and I know my girls are watching like hawks. So how we teach is a way in which we express our love. Our tradition would see that, you know, kind of free-range parenting would not be the way that Jews are supposed to parent, because our tradition would see that as lazy. That our tradition is about, you have rules, you have expectations, you have boundaries, and it's through those boundaries and expectations that you express your love. So this next prayer is really about our opportunity to think about, how am I going to teach this year? What am I going to teach? Who am I going to teach it to? From the way in which we talk on the phone to the way in which we treat people, those customer service lines, anything that we do, we are, in fact, teaching. And the setting of this next song is a beautiful setting. It's written by a friend of Julie and mine named Gabriel Mann, and he wrote it for his daughter's bat mitzvah a few years ago. And then he and his daughter performed it at her bat mitzvah, and it was beautiful. And I was lucky to be there at the premiere, so to speak. And it, again, is an example of Gabe teaching his daughter the power of creativity, the power of collaboration. And so as you listen to this setting of Ahavat Olam, I want you to think about, what are you going to teach this year? Because we're all teachers. How are you going to walk into this new year with your wisdom and help to make the world a place full of more and more love?
Ahavat Olam, Beit Yisrael. Otanu limadetan.
Ahavat Olam.
Beit Yisrael.
Amcha Ahavta.
Torah u'mitzvot. Chukim u'mishpatim.
In just a moment, we're all going to stand together to recite the words of the Shema, which you can find on page 28. But this evening of Kol Nidrei and then tomorrow at Yom Kippur is the one time of year that we recite that second part out loud. Because tonight we dress in white, we're not eating, we're not drinking water, and it's said that we are like the angels in Jacob's ladder, going down and up and down and up. Therefore, we have a right to say those words. So I'm going to invite you all up on page 28 as we recite the words of our people, the words of the Shema.
Shema!
Normally in services, this is the moment where we all recite together the words of the Ve'ahavta. But tonight we're going to do it a little bit differently. We have an English version of the Ve'ahavta. Same words, same meaning. But I'm going to invite Sadie Tanner Rose up to sing this beautiful melody for us, which speaks of the love that we need to show in the world now that we've seen God's love through Ahavat Olam.
Thank you.
What an extraordinary way to begin Yom Kippur. For me, growing up, Kol Nidrei consisted of playing with my dad's tallis and asking more times, are we there yet, than not. But what a remarkable beginning to this Day of Atonement. On page 40, we come to our Micha Mocha. Micha Mocha, we sing daily. November, February, May. We sing these words on a daily basis, but how do we sing them differently tonight? Tonight on this Kol Nidrei, as we enter this 24 hours of reflection and repentance, we simply have to go back to the story. There we were, standing at the shore of the sea. Behind us was 400 years of oppression, 400 years of pain and 400 years of heartache, 400 years of generations waiting for that Micha moment, waiting for that Micha Mocha moment where they were going to find their redemption and be brought to liberation. So how do we sing Micha Mocha differently tonight? Well, we think back to our own year. Moments in our own year that we were enslaved. Moments in this past year that we wanted to break through. Moments in this past year that we wanted to get to our own edge of the seashore and walk through to our liberation. And as we look around the world tonight, there are many people that are waiting for their Micha Mocha moment. There are many people waiting for us to be that Nachshon, that person to step foot in the water first and say, follow me, it's going to be okay. So as we sing these words together tonight, as we repent for this past year, let us think of the ways that we can part the sea. Let us think of the ways that we can bring that feeling of redemption to those who cry out from the depth, hear me, answer me, liberate me. Micha Mocha, page 40.
Micha Mocha,
The poet Yehuda Amichai wrote about peace. And he wrote wild peace, not the lion and the lamb lying together, not the sound of signatures by world leaders, but a feeling of calm and a feeling of hope and a feeling of love. On page 42 with Hashkivenu, our prayer for peace does not talk about the end of war, although that is something we pray for. But what does Hashkivenu talk about? It asks us to lie down in peace, and God spread over us that sukkah shalom, that fragile, fragile sukkah, because we know that peace is vulnerable. Peace, an opportunity to lie down at night, unafraid of what is out there, secure with what is inside. May we sing this song for peace tonight, and may it guide us into this new year.
Hashkivenu, Hashkivenu, Adonai. Hashkivenu, Adonai, Eloheinu, Leshalom. Ve'amideinu, Malkeinu, Lechayim, Uleshalom, Uleshalom.
Last week for Rosh Hashanah on our Haftorah, we learned about one of the great figures in our tradition, Chana. Chana was tormented by all whom she came in contact with, yet Chana didn't sit down. Chana stood up, and Chana offered a prayer that was so powerful. No one else in the tradition had ever seen a prayer such as Chana's. And why was it so powerful? Because she prayed in silence. Sometimes there are words that are so strong. Sometimes the prayers on our heart are so in need that the words in which we use on a daily basis are too little. So on page 50, we're going to rise and we're going to offer our silent Amidah. And we're going to pray in a way that Hannah prayed. And you can go through the pages on the book, 50 to 58, or you can close the book and find the words within your heart. But take this opportunity and offer these words of prayer.
If you've not yet completed your prayers, please, there's no rush. For the rest of you, you may be seated. At the end of our Amidah, the Talmud records all of these personal meditations that the rabbis would have done. So there's always a moment for private meditation. And the one that we're about to do, Elohai Netzor, which you can find on page 80, it asks us to guard our tongues from doing wrong. I think there's like a little funny thing about the tongue being the strongest muscle in the body. It's the hardest to control. And so many of what we will do in the Vidui, so many of what we'll say and we'll confess has to do with the sins of our mouths, the way that we talk about people, the mean things that come out in those times of anger. And so this private meditation, Elohai Netzor, is meant to be a mantra of sorts, a reminder that it's constantly our responsibility to guard our tongues and to always speak words of godliness.
Elohai Netzor Lashoni Mira Usvatai Medaber Mima Velim Kalilai Nafshi Tidol Venafshi Ke'afar Lakol
Great psychoanalyst Carl Jung said, "Your visions will become clear only when you can look into your heart. Who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakes." We spend most of the year looking outside, looking at what other people are doing, looking how we are perceived by other people. But this is the day where we are supposed to look inside. And this is not a time where we are supposed to actually be depressed by that fact. Actually, when we look inside, and yes, we see our faults, we see where we've fallen short, there's almost a relief that comes with being honest with yourself, because we know that we spend most of the year lying to ourselves. And so this is our opportunity with this next section, the Vidui section, the confessional, to really be honest with ourselves and look inside and awaken ourselves to the reality, yes, we've made mistakes, and yes, we know we can do better. And when we do that, there is a joy that comes with the relief of being honest with ourselves. So at the end, and in the refrain of the Ashamnu, there's almost, as you can feel it, a joy associated with the fact that being honest with yourself really just is the only way we really should be. So we turn now to page 82, and I ask you to please rise.
I, 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 I,
Let's read the English translation together. Of these wrongs we are guilty. We betray, we steal, we scorn, we act perversely, we are cruel, we scheme, we are violent, we slander, we devise evil, we lie, we ridicule, we disobey, we abuse, we defy, we corrupt, we commit crimes, we are hostile, we are stubborn, we are immoral, we kill, we spoil, we go astray, we lead others astray.
Ay, 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 ay.
Page 86.
Al chit shechatanu lefanecha bezadonu vishkaga. Al chit shechatanu lefanecha bedibur peh.
The ways we have wronged you deliberately and by mistake, and harm we have caused in your world through the words of our mouths.
Al chit shechatanu lefanecha bimutzalev. Al chit shechatanu lefanecha betivshut peh.
Join me. The ways we have wronged you by hardening our hearts, and harm we have caused in your world through careless speech.
Al chit shechatanu lefanecha bechachash vechazav. Al chit shechatanu lefanecha birchilut.
The ways we have wronged you through lies and deceit, and harm we have caused in your world through gossip and rumor.
Ve'al kulam Eloh aselichot zelach lanu mechalanu kapelanu al chet shechatanu lefanecha biflilut ve'al chet shechatanu lefanecha bezilzul horim amorim.
The ways we have wronged you by judging others unfairly, and harm we have caused in your world through disrespect to parents and teachers.
Al chet shechatanu lefanecha bividupei, ve'al chet shechatanu lefanecha behona'at re'ah.
The ways we have wronged you through insincere apologies, and harm we have caused in your world by mistreating a friend or neighbor.
Al chet shechatanu lefanecha bechozek yad, ve'al chet shechatanu lefanecha b'masa uv'matan.
The ways we have wronged you through violence and abuse, and harm we have caused in your world through dishonesty in business.
Ve'al kulam
failures of judgment and will, God of forgiveness, forgive us, pardon us, lead us to atonement. You may be seated. On Sunday afternoon, there were hundreds of people from this community who gathered on the beach in Santa Monica for this funky little ritual that our tradition has called Tashlich, where you're supposed to take pieces of bread and toss them into the water and imagine that with each piece of bread, you are throwing away one of your sins from the year. It's really funky, but it is a lot of fun, and it's a great excuse to go to the beach here in LA. There's this idea, the word Tashlich is found in this next prayer, the Shema Koleinu. If you look on page 98, look down towards the last paragraph, you'll see, do not cast us away from your presence or cut us off from your Holy Spirit. Do not cast us away when we are old, as our strength diminishes. Do not forsake us. Do not forsake us, Adonai. Be not far from us, your God, our God. This idea of being tossed away, I remember I had my heart broken when I was younger, and I felt like I was tossed away, right? You know, those moments where you feel like you just get tossed to the curb, and it feels awful. And we're supposed to imagine what it's like to be tossed away. And this prayer that the cantor does is supposed to be this plea, please do not toss me away like trash. Do not toss me away when I'm feeling low. Please just remember that I can be better. I am not worth just tossing to the side. I am worthy. That is what the cantor is singing on our behalf, to basically say, as we are all supposed to be saying, we have worth. We are willing to do better. Please do not cast me away. Hold me close to you. I promise you I will do better in this coming year. Shema Koleinu.
Thank you. On the morning of December 2nd, 2020, Tim Brown got up early to light a fire. The night before, an unseasonable cold front had descended on Love's Landing, Florida, where Brown lived with his wife. By 8 a.m., the mercury in the thermometer had yet to reach 40 degrees. At the end of the cul-de-sac where the couple lived, a thin layer of frost glistened on the long grass runways that extended through the quiet neighborhood. Love's Landing is a private aviation community, home to pilots, plane engineers, and flight enthusiasts. Brown had just raised the door to the hangar when an unmarked Dodge Durango roared into the driveway, along with Marion County police cruisers. As Brown turned toward the commotion, a law enforcement officer in a tactical vest leapt out of his SUV. He was pointing an MK-18 short-barreled automatic rifle at Brown's face. "Step back. Raise your hands," the agent shouted, as officers from half a dozen law enforcement agencies fanned out across the property. For the previous 35 years, Tim Brown had been living a carefully constructed lie. He wasn't just an aging retiree with a passion for aviation. In fact, he wasn't Tim Brown at all. His real name was Howard Farley Jr. And law enforcement determined that he'd been the leader of one of the largest drug trafficking rings in Nebraska history. At some point in 1985, after indictments against his network were unsealed, Farley vanished. Now, 35 years later, he was facing a convoy of law enforcement officers. "He knew the jig was up," said the agent in charge, confronting Brown in the hangar. "When you turn around and smile to someone that's pointing a fully automatic rifle at you, you know the run is over." 4 decades on the run. 4 decades of escape. 4 decades of pretending. 4 decades living a lie. It's astonishing. It's incredible. How on earth did he manage to do it? We ask ourselves. Are we so different? Now, I know what you may be thinking. Yes, Rabbi, I am so different. I'm not a fugitive. I'm not a drug trafficker. I'm not on the run, trying to escape, pretending to be someone I'm not. Fair enough. I'll concede that none of us here tonight is a fugitive or a wanted criminal. The temple's security is too good for that. But the truth is, if we're honest with ourselves, many of us are running. We are trying to escape something. We are walking through life day after day, playing a part, pretending in ways large and small. We all wear masks. And I'm not talking about a KN95. We run. We run from our childhoods and messy relationships, from conflict and uncomfortable situations. We run from failure and feelings and family, from our insecurities and our doubt. We run from our self-doubt and from ourselves. We escape. We escape through work and soul cycle, the vape pen, the gummies and the bottle, with food and gambling, spending, sex, and sleep. We escape with the lies we tell others, the lies we tell ourselves. We play a role. We pretend. We pretend we have it all together, that our relationships are perfect, our families are perfect, our marriages are perfect. Just look at our Facebook and Instagram posts. We pretend we can afford it, that we're happy, confident, and healthy. We pretend we can handle it. We're not hurt. We're okay. We pretend we care. It's exhausting, isn't it? Funny how many masks we all wear, the lengths we go, consciously or not, to pretend. Who are we pretending to be? Who are we trying to fool with the personae we create? Think about the titles so many of us wear. Spouse, parent, boss, coach, teacher, therapist, nurse, president, CEO, manager, doctor, lawyer, rabbi. In my second year of rabbinical school, I had a student pulpit in Yuma, Arizona. Student pulpits are small, out-of-the-way places with a handful of Jews that cannot sustain a full-time or even a part-time rabbi. So they arranged to have a rabbinical student visit once a month to play rabbi. I remember my first visit to Yuma like it was yesterday. I arrived on what I was told was a mild Friday afternoon in August. It was only 118. I checked into the Quality Inn, dropped my bag, and caught a reflection of myself in the mirror. I didn't look like a rabbi. I sure as hell didn't feel like a rabbi. Yet there I was. An hour later, I arrived at Dr. Kravitz's home for Shabbat dinner. His wife, Jackie, opened the door and introduced herself. Then she turned and called to her son, Cooper. Coop! Coop, come on out and meet the new rabbi. At which point, I turned around as well, eager to meet the new rabbi. This went on for 2 years. One weekend a month, venturing deep into the desert and playing dress-up rabbi. My constant worry? What if they figure out I don't know much more about the Torah than they do? After all, in a way, that's really what the job was. Pretending to be the wise, confident, all-knowing rabbi they didn't have. That was a long time ago. And Wilshire Boulevard Temple is a long way from Yuma. And I'd like to think that I've learned a lot since then. About the Torah, about life. Still, sometimes I wonder if I have become the wise, confident, all-knowing rabbi I aspire to be. I ask myself, am I authentic? Don't we all ask ourselves the same question? Are we our authentic selves? Are we hiding from our authentic selves? We would hardly be the first. Consider Adam and Eve in the garden. After eating from the tree of knowledge and discovering who they really are, they hear God and they run. They run and hide. Or Jacob, who lies and cheats his brother Esau out of his inheritance, only to run for the hills when the truth comes out, unwilling to face the consequences of his actions. And years later, poor Jacob again tries to escape his reality. This time from his father-in-law, after robbing him blind. And of course, there's Jonah. Jonah, who in the Haftarah we will read tomorrow afternoon, is asked by God to go to Nineveh and convince the Assyrians to repent, but runs to Jaffa instead and boards a ship to Tunisia to escape being a prophet. What do Adam and Eve, Jacob and Jonah all have in common? They were afraid. After all, that's why we run and try to escape, isn't it? Fear. Because we're afraid. What are we so afraid of? The most repeated commandment in the Hebrew Bible is a very simple phrase, Al tira, don't be afraid. 122 times the Tanakh commands us, not about tzedakah or Shabbat, sacrifices or kashrut, but al tira, don't be afraid. Honesty dispels fear. If we can be honest with ourselves about what we're so afraid of, about what we're running from, then we diminish its power, and we can stop trying to escape it. My friend Leon was a camp song leader in the heyday of Jewish folk music in the 70s, along with Debbie Friedman, Jeff Klepper, and Danny Freelander, to name a few. Inspired by Debbie, they reimagined what synagogue music could be, and Jeff and Danny went on to be rabbis and cantors, and Debbie might as well have. Leon, on the other hand, landed in the cybersecurity department for a large financial services institution. Just like his friends, he loved the world of Jewish music, but he was afraid and figured he needed to get a real job. So he escaped and left it behind. He was successful in that real job for 17 years. And for 17 years, he would spend nights in his basement playing guitar and writing music, living a double life, as he put it to me many years ago when we first met. One day I realized I just couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't keep running. And that's how Leon ended up in cantorial school at the age of 45. And now 20 years later, a cantor and prolific composer. Stacy and her doting husband are the parents of two adorable twins. At 27, she was the youngest woman ever to make partner at her law firm. And the 90-hour week she billed made her a rainmaker. Then the pandemic hit, and those 90-hour weeks collided with the reality of working from home, her twins, and her husband. It was barely a month into lockdown when Stacy realized that there were deep fractures in her emotional connection to her husband. I didn't know how to connect to him and support him, Stacy shares. Probably because my own mother was unemotionally available. So it was easier to pour myself into work, to run, to escape, rather than face the deficits in our marriage. COVID forced me to face them, to face my fears, to face myself. I'm back in the office now, but I have more balance. I'm investing time in my marriage the same way I used to invest it in my work. I'm no longer trying to escape. Tomorrow morning, Jews all over the world will hear the words of the special Torah portion the rabbis selected for Yom Kippur morning, imploring us to choose life. It's a beautiful sentiment. Choose life. But how? What does that mean? The medieval Italian commentator Sforno explains that to choose life means to choose one's true life. To choose to live as our true, authentic selves. It is no accident that we read this Torah portion on Yom Kippur, because Yom Kippur is an invitation to choose life, to stop running, to stop trying to escape, to stop pretending and face ourselves. Really face ourselves. After nearly 3 years of my suits collecting dust in my closet, I reached for one a few weeks ago, only to find that it didn't quite fit the way I remembered it fitting. So it was off to the tailor. Standing there in front of that three-way mirror, I see sides of myself I don't recognize. Sides I've never seen before. Is that really what I look like to the world, I wonder? Is my posture actually that bad? My shoulders that hunched? My hair that thin? The older we get, the harder it is to face ourselves. To look at ourselves in the mirror and really see ourselves. With each passing year, we recognize the face looking back at us less and less. Whose wrinkles are those? Whose pores? Whose bags under the eyes? That gray hair that seems to multiply overnight is my father's, not mine. So we try not to look too closely. We spackle our outsides with potions, lotions, and hair dye. A little Botox here, a nip tuck there. But what about our insides? What role do we play in our dysfunctional relationship with our in-laws, in our children not calling, in our marriages, in our workplace? What role do we play in our own unhappiness? Are we brave enough to find out? Do we have the courage to stop running, to stop trying to escape, to stop pretending, to face ourselves for who we are, who we really are? Cheshbon HaNefesh, the work of honestly examining our lives, takes courage. It cannot happen unless we're honest with ourselves. This is the one time of year when it really is all about us. This is a time to be completely self-centered. We are supposed to turn inward, to focus on our lives, our marriages, our families, our children, our behavior. What are you running from? Force yourself to answer. Right now. What are you trying to escape? What are you so afraid of? Examine your life, the Talmud implores us, because the rabbis knew, just like we know, that being honest, truly honest with ourselves, has the power to change us in a way nothing else can. So let's stop running. Let's stop being fugitives from our own potential. Let's look deeply into that giant three-way mirror. Let's choose to live as our true, authentic selves. Let's stop trying to escape because we know there is none. In the words of the psalmist, where shall we go from your spirit? Where shall we flee from your presence? If we ascend into heaven, you are there. If we make our bed in the netherworld, behold, you are there. If we take the wings of morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there do you lead us and hold us. Tonight, of all nights, there is nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. So let's stop pretending. Let's see ourselves for who we really are. Let's be present in our own lives. Let's choose life, a true life.
Sad eyes, don't be discouraged, oh, I realize it's hard to take courage in a world full of people. You can lose sight of it all, the darkness inside you can make you feel so small, and I see your truth colors shining through, and I see your truth.
Just a few announcements before we conclude our service this evening. First of all, thank you to Sadie for lending your beautiful voice, to Deborah and Donna, wherever they are, Cantor Lisa, to the quartet, to the band, to Rabbi Shapiro, Rabbi Simons. Thank you all. Thank you all for being here. We will be doing our Koleinu service tomorrow at 11:30 if you want to come back and join us for our daytime service. At the end of the day, there are many services. At 6:30, there will be a breakfast. If you stick around that long through the full day, there will be a breakfast on Siegel Patio right outside there. There are a few afternoon options for you if you do want to stick around after the Koleinu service and then stay for the Yisker, Nila, etc. There's a special film screening, The Ritchie Boys, at 11:15 and at 2:15 in Stalford Hall. There's a discussion about separation of church and state, A Breach in the Wall, and that's at 2 p.m. Here, where you can join an in-depth discussion about what happens to Jews and other minorities when government embraces God. You can stop by the Browerman Elementary School yard and put together some hygiene kits for the Karsh Center. That's between 2 and 4:30. We want to make a lot of them. It doesn't take long to make, so you can just go over there, and before you know it, you will have made 20. You can visit Gen Space, which is on the third floor, for a meditation room, and just to see that space tomorrow afternoon between 2:15 and 3:45. And by the way, the entire building, the whole Audrey Irmas Pavilion, will be open tomorrow, so you can be, you can go and wander, so to speak, through all of the different floors. I definitely recommend you go up on the roof at some point as well to see the view from there. And there's also a self-guided tour of the Karsh Center between 2 and 4:30 p.m. If you haven't been there, or you haven't been there in a while, I highly recommend it. It's in the parking lot over there. I think that's it for announcements. We're going to turn now to page 122 in our Machzor for the Mourner's Kaddish, to think about those who are not here but whom we are definitely thinking of on this holiday. So if there is someone special in your life whom you're thinking of, if you could just rise at this time and share the name. I'll just go around like this and we can share the names, please. I ask you to please rise. Let's join together. Yid gadol vi kadash shemei rabba. Be'alma divrach yirutei ve'amlich malchutei. B'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chayei d'chol beit Yisrael. Ba'agalav v'izman kari v'imru. Amen. Yehe shmei rabba mevrach le'olam olmei olmaya. Yid barach v'ishtabach v'itpa'ar v'itromam v'itnasei. Vitadar vitale vitalal shmei dekudisha brichu leela uleela mi kol birchata vishirata tushbechata venechamata da miran belma vimru amen. Yehe shlama rabba min shemaya vechaim alenu veol kol Yisrael vimru amen. Ose shalom bimromav hu yase shalom alenu veol kol Yisrael vimru.
Amen. We conclude our Kol Nidrei service with the words of the psalmist, Olam Chesed Yibaneh, a world of kindness we will build with the work that we do for these next 25 hours.
Olam Chesed Yibaneh.
Chesed Yibaneh, Yadadai, 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 Dai. Olam Chesed Yibaneh, Yadadai, 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 Dai.
Good night, everyone. Shana Tova. We'll see you tomorrow.